So, talk about it. Scrubland is a really great, and I will tell you what I mean by all of these things in this film. And everything I'm going to talk about today is joint work with Robbie McKee. So first, let me say what I mean by this Grothendieck ring. So this is the Grothendieck ring varieties. I'll fix the LK. And first make the Grothendieck group of varieties over K by simply making a free abelian group on all the varieties, formally on classes of varieties, maybe I should say, over each isomorphism class of variety. I take one variety and just put some brackets around it and make a class, and then I'm going to impose some relations, the cut and paste relations that I'm going to set that essentially say that the class of variety should be equal to the sum of its pieces. So if I have I have the class of x plus the class of y, it is the class of z whenever x and z is a closed subvariety and y is the complement. So whenever I have whenever I can break variety z into a closed piece and the open complement, I say that the class of the variety is equal to the sum of the classes. So those are the relations that are imposed. And so, so it starts out there, starts its life as a group, and then you can also impose a ring structure by saying that the product of classes is just equal to the class of the product variety. So as an example of the first sorts of examples of the kind of calculus done here, so we use L, or Lefschetz actually, to denote the class of the line. The affine line, and then 1 will be the class of a point, which makes sense because it's the multiplicative identity with this product. And so then you can write things like, well, the class of an, that's the n full product of the line, so that's L to the n, and the class of p2, well, you could break that up into, that's an a2 and a A1 and a point. So P2 is L squared plus L plus 1. So this is the sort of feel of a variety is the sum of its pieces. Some particularly important relations that come up a lot. So one example would be blow up X of Y, that class is, well, you have x and then you throw away y and you add the exceptional divisor. And in fact, Bittner proved that you can replace these cut and paste relations with these blow up relations, even just on smooth projective or smooth proper varieties, and get the same thing. The other important kind of relation that comes up is, for example, if V is an n-dimensional vector bundle over X, then the class of V is L to the n times the class of X. Now, this is if you had a trivial vector bundle over X, then this would, you know, follow exactly from this product that I wrote here. But of course, in general, a vector bundle isn't a trivial product of An with the space, but you can find a Zariski open where it is trivial, and then you cut that piece out, and then you work down, then you're down in dimension, and you do more more cuttings. You can cut this X into pieces over which the vector bundle is trivial, and then when you add them all up, you see that the class of a vector bundle is L to the n times the class of X, and you of course can do similar things for other bundles. So I'm particularly interested in two connections of what happens in this growth and decreasing of varieties with other things outside of it. So one is that if K is a finite field, everything, this construction in relation to respect point counting over K, counting the number of points of the variety over a finite field. So there's this, so there's a point counting map, you know, to the integers where X goes to the number of points, the number of K points of X, or in fact, you can count points over any extension of K. And this product structure and the cut and paste relation obviously hold for point counting, so we get a well-defined thing here. So it's a refinement over a finite field of point counting. And so that is one important connection for me, because it will relate to questions about counting points on varieties over finite fields. And another important connection is in the case when the field is the complex numbers. So then this the class of variety in the growth and decreasing of varieties says something about the cohomology of the variety. So so just the singular topological cohomology, so this is compactly supported, but the basic topological invariance of the space X, you can actually, in many cases, see a lot about from the class of X in the growth and decreasing. And let me say what enables that. So, this cohomology of an algebraic variety has not only the grading by degree that the cohomology of an ordinary topological space has, but it also has the, so there was the degree, but it also has the second thing here. So besides the grading by degree, this has a filtration by weight. Part of the mixed Hodge structure on the cohomology of the variety. It's the mixed part in the Hodge structure. There's also the Hodge part that's kind of orthogonal to what I'm going to talk about. And so, let's see So if X is a smooth projective variety, we don't really see this weight in the cohomology, that the weight that this second this filtration is the same as the degree. Okay, so now I'm going to say what the class in the growth and degree of varieties has anything to do with this. Cohomology. So the Hodge-Leene polynomial is just a gadget for keeping track of the cohomology by weight. So here, this is the Betti number that gives the dimension, you know, the dimension over Q of the cohomology, and this D is the degree, and this K is the weight. And here I have a formal variable to keep track of the weight. So I'm doing an Euler characteristic over degree, where I put all the cohomology of different degrees together. But I can keep track of the weight. If I threw out the weight, right? If z was 1, then this would just be the compactly supported Euler characteristic. But I have this formal variable z here, so I can keep track of the information in each weight. And this is actually an invariant of the class in the Grothendieck ring. And in fact, the ring structure is compatible. So okay, so if you haven't seen this before, this is something that I think at first should be very surprising, because when you only have the class of a class of a variety in the Grothendieck ring, you somehow, it's a little bit like knowing what the pieces are, but not how they were glued together. And this says, from that class, you can obtain some real information about the cohomology. So, in particular, is that this? Is that better? Okay, so this Hodge-Leene polynomial that I wrote down, right? It keeps track of the weight of the cohomology, but I said that in the case x is smooth and projective, that the weight is the same information as the degree. So when x is smooth and projective, this Hodge-Leene polynomial is just the Poincaré polynomial. It just is keeping track of the Betti numbers of the rational cohomology of the space at every degree. So for example, that says that if x and y are smooth and projective, and they have the same class, then they have the same rational cohomology. So then, okay. So I mean, okay, what's maybe. What's an example of, well, maybe it's hard to cut something up and put it back in the smooth projective thing, but so here's a good example. So P1 cross P1, that's the same class as the globe of P2 in a point, right? So this is L plus 1 times L plus 1, so P1 is the affine line plus a point, right? And this is you had your P2, and then you took away the point, and then you added back the line. So these are the same, not the same even topological space, but they have the same class in the Grothendieck ring of varieties, and therefore have the same rational cohomology.
Didn't Yes. So they have the same bedding numbers, but the ring structure is a little different.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, this equals is kind of a, I mean, it's really, the dimensions are equals. Okay, so, and I should say that I highlight the case when x and y are smooth and projective because there, this Hodge-Dilling polynomial captures the entire information about the singular cohomology of a variety, but even when the variety isn't smooth and projective, the weights aren't arbitrary. I mean, even there are sort of soft inequalities in general, and in special cases, you might, you know some more about the weights. And so there's a lot of information, even when, and I'll say maybe at the very end, get to an example, where even when something is not smooth and projective, knowing this Hodge-Dilling polynomial can in fact, you know, with a few other pieces of information, can in fact tell you everything about the cohomology by degree.
Yeah,
in the direction that makes this converge. So arbitrary negative dimension, yes. Yes. Right. But only finitely much positive dimension. Okay, so let me, so I said I was going to talk about classes of various spaces in this growth and degree, and so I will start with an example, maybe. You bring the board for. So smooth plane curves of degree D. So inside of the affine space of all homogeneous degree D forms in three variables. So equations for curves of degree D. Some of those equations give smooth plane curves. So I will just, I will maybe write that as smooth plane curves, but perhaps when we're thinking about it more generally, more convenient notation is to do something like just add a smooth on the end of here. So this is, you know, this is an affine space, and this is an open locus in this affine space. And this is, of course, the complement of the discriminant locus. So a plane, there's a discriminant in the coefficients of a degree D homogeneous form in three variables that determines whether or not the curve is smooth. And so I'll call that discriminants of D. So so the smooth locus is the complement of this discriminant locus. And so in the title of my talk, discriminants in the growth and degree, this is what I mean, classes of things like these discriminants. Now, of course, in the growth and degree, since we perfectly well understand what this is, you know, it's affine space of dimension, I think you just said in the last topic, D plus 2 choose 2, knowing the classes of these discriminants in the growth and degree is completely equivalent to knowing the classes of the moduli of smooth plane curves. So depending on your interest, you might say it in one way or the other. And so these discriminant polynomials in the coefficients of the form get pretty complicated. For example, even for plane conics, the discriminant polynomial is a degree 3 polynomial with 5 terms, but already for plane cubics, it's a degree 12 polynomial with 2,040 terms. So, so in that sense, these, as D is getting bigger, these discriminant varieties are getting more and more complicated. But in fact, it turns out in the growth and degree, the sequences, and whether you think of them as the sequences of the smooth open locus or the complement, the discriminant locus, they actually have nice behavior as D increases. So, this sequence, instead of getting more and more complicated and out of control, actually has nice limiting behavior. So. We imagine that this might be the case because we are, you know, I said we had these two connections, one to Quinn County and one to Pomology, because we already knew that this sequence, if you take point counts of this sequence over a finite field, that it has nice limiting behavior. So this is a theorem of Poonen from 2004. And it says that over some finite field, if you look inside of the linear, you have some x and some variable line bundle, or say just sitting inside a projective space. If you look inside of the linear system of all degree d divisors, and say you're counting those over your finite field, and inside of that you look at, well, how many in that linear system, how many of those are smooth divisors? So adopting this notation, so here, right, this here is just an affine space, this linear system of all the degree d divisors, and this says inside of there's some open locus of smooth things, and you could think of this as, right, the probability that a random large degree divisor is smooth. And so Poonen says that, in fact, this has very nice behavior in this sequence as D gets big, even though these action varieties, in a lot of senses, get more and more complicated. The point counts, so this exists, and not only exists, but you can, I didn't say what, and it has a particular value in terms of the zeta function of the variety. I won't get too much into what the particular values mean, but that there is some particular meaningful value. And so the fact that a sequence of spaces has in the limit, even though the varieties are getting more and more complicated, a nice point count. Now, I could have said this just as well for the discriminant varieties, and then this would be a 1 minus this, of course. So,
so you're doing the affine thing.
Yeah, it wouldn't matter if you did the projective thing. I mean, in the limit, yeah.
Is it evident that this is divisible by q minus 1 because of the multiplicative
group? Yeah. So if you instead, you could instead do the projective thing, the sort of one point that you have to throw out you don't see in the limit, and then you can, then there's a factor of q minus 1 that cancels out. So is that what you're saying?
If you just knew the right-hand side, would you see that this is divisible?
Oh, well, that's an interesting question. If x doesn't have a rational point, I mean, it's sort of what's divisible because there's this denominator.
Right, the denominator is.
But, yeah, no, I don't know that you always have to visibly see the, but, yeah, okay, but anyway, so, so this is what made us wonder whether, whether there is actually, structure as d goes to infinity in this sequence of, moduli spaces of smooth divisors in a linear system as d goes to infinity. And in fact, there is the exact So I should almost have just written over the theorem because it looks exactly the same, except that instead of point counting, I'm now taking the classes in the Grothendieck ring. And now you can see here both why I needed to invert L so that I could put this affine space in the denominator, and why there needs to be some completion for this to be meaningful because it's a limit. And so this is.
You're using D in two dimensions.
Oh, sorry. Sorry. Yes. Thank you. Is that fixed it?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, I was going to use it there too, and then I just turned my D into dim X, so I'll do the same trick over here. So it's the same as all, of course this has to mean something slightly different. But this, so this is the Kapranov's motivic zeta function. Okay. And so it says that in fact it's not just the number of points, but that if we look at actually the classes of these spaces, and I think somehow the open locus, it feels like, oh, it's just an open locus of affine space, that's not so bad. I think that what is particularly surprising is when you think about it in terms of the complements, the discriminants, that these varieties are getting crazier and crazier, but yet they have this, they're somehow the pieces that you can break them up into have this nice limiting structure. So, I want to say something. So these theorems, the statements of them are cosmetically identical, but in fact, what is behind them is pretty different. So first of all, I should say that this theorem does not imply Kuhn's theorem for the reason that I said that this point counting isn't compatible with the dimensional filtration. So the technique here uses this what's called a closed point sieve, where you go point by point over the possible points in your divisor and say, okay, throw out the stuff that's not smooth here, throw out the stuff that's not smooth here, and over a finite field you can go point by point through the points. So this is over any variety, we're particularly thinking about C, for example, and so there's nothing like that kind of closed point sieve. Actually, interestingly, we do use finite fields in our proof here, even for K, the complex numbers, in the following way. So, okay, when I did the very first example, it looks like, oh, breaking these things into pieces, that seems kind of simple-minded, but in fact, what we do is have these pieces and we build vector bundles over them and we break those into pieces, and then some of those pieces are vector bundles over other things and we build vector bundles over those pieces. It gets complicated enough that we express something as a sum of a lot of different terms and we hope a lot of those terms don't appear, so there's a lot of work to prove that there's cancellation. And at some point we know that a class, we have something where we know that some class we're interested in is a sum of multiples of some other classes, but we don't know what the coefficients are. And so where we use finite fields is to get the result even over complex numbers is we show that the coefficients don't depend essentially on whether we were over the complex numbers or a finite field, and then we can use the point counting realization over a finite field to figure out what these coefficients are in a sum. So that's how we use point counting over finite fields even to prove the result to the result over C. So that's, but it's, you know, it's completely, it's it, you know, it's a very different looking proof, I should say. Another thing that makes the flavor of the mathematics behind this actually very different is we also have in the same way we prove an analog where instead of smooth, where smooth is replaced by exactly S singularities. So you fix some S and you ask for, well, what about the moduli space of divisors with exactly one singularity or exactly two singularities? And we also prove that that limit exists and give a zeta formula for it. And we then conjecture, it's clear what we conjecture the point count to be. But as I said, because point counting isn't compatible with this completion, we don't actually have a theorem, but we have a conjecture, I think a reasonably accessible conjecture about the probability that a large degree divisor over a finite field has exactly S singularities, but it doesn't follow directly from the same method that Poonen uses to count smooth divisors. So, okay. So that is an example where what passes through these connections, the point counting is just sort of conjecture. This led us to conjecture something like this was true. And then we also, you know, in the method and the mathematics that you have to do in the Grothendieck ring, we can see just as easily that you can count for S singularities, and that just leads us to conjecture something about point counting for S singularities. And
could you remind us what the Kapranov zeta function is?
Yeah. So the coefficients are the, usually there's a capital Z, first is a capital Z. So the coefficients are the symmetric products. So so it's a power series, the coefficients are the symmetric products, and when you write the little z, the little zeta, sorry, that just means plug in T equals L to the minus dim X minus 1. So the little zeta. When you write the little zeta, that is just changing the variable from p to this exponent of, right? So if I had written this instead, so little zeta n is this L minus. Oh, I should use n. Yeah, s would be good. Sorry, use s on that board. Okay. All right. So. Okay, so let's see. So for so what about cohomology? So this this result then suggests that there is homological stability for these spaces. Let's just go back to our first example, because when we proved this theorem, this wasn't even known, that if you look at these spaces, say of smooth plane curves of growing degree, that as the degree grows, this suggests that their rational cohomology or rational homology, same thing, stabilizes. It doesn't prove it because these aren't projective spaces, but it suggests it. And so this homological stability, this is a very active topic in topology where for a lot of spaces, so there's say some sequence of spaces, and then the homological stability says that if you look at it, you know, the J homology, and I'll just say here with rational coefficients, and if you fix J, you say I'm going to look at the seventh homology group. That is that for J sufficiently large, for N sufficiently large given J, you know, this is stable. This doesn't depend on N. And probably most familiar to the algebraic geometers, for example, are the results on the moduli space of curves and mapping class groups. But topologists study these for automorphisms of free groups and configuration spaces and you know, GLN and other analogs of algebraic groups and prove theorems about the homological stability. And so since this gives this, you know, this does imply, in fact, so this limit is compatible with the Hodge-Dalin polynomial, and so it does imply a sort of, instead of by degree, homological stability, so by weight homological stability, and suggests that there probably is that homological stability. And in fact, so that led us to conjecture this, and then it's now is a theorem. Tomasi proved homological stability. I'll say for degree d going to infinity hypersurfaces in Pn, so not just smooth plane curves that I was saying there, but in any projective space. And this is the best kind of result. No, so this is what our theorem suggests. When X is projective space. But of course, we conjecture that homological stability is true for, hey, we'll conjecture, you know, for any certainly smooth algebraic variety. And just recently it's known for projective space. So.
Is this a statement about Betty numbers or are there natural maps? Can you get kind of boundary maps on the boundary that you...
Yeah, so that's a great question. So this is a statement about Betty numbers. And I think that's one of the things that makes it a little harder. I mean, until recently, a lot of the homological stability results in topology came from where there were actually maps on the spaces that then induced these isomorphisms, and now the sort of more recent work is in the situations where you don't have a map. Now here, this is really, there's not even something. Sometimes you don't have a map, but you have some other space that you have maps from, and something that's kind of like a map. But here there is really not any kind of thing that is naturally giving this in on the space level. So I think that's a really interesting question to somehow, just think about it in terms of, from plane curves, kind of taking a plane curve of degree d and getting the d plus 1. You know, I mean, obviously those kinds of maps are critical in a lot of the older homological stability results, but here, so this somehow, you know, this, what happened in the Grover degree of varieties, I think one advantage of it is that we don't have maps at all, we're not thinking of maps at all between the spaces, but it sort of let us see where there might be this kind of structure where somehow the maps weren't sitting there staring you in the face. Okay, so, I want to I'll say what I mean by these spaces. Okay, so this configuration space, so this is the space of distinct points in X. And I put several numbers up there because they're going to be somewhat distinguished. Say D white and N1 red into blue. So they're somewhat distinguished, but all the white ones you can't tell them apart. So this is like inside of the symmetric product there's some open locus where none of the points come together, and then you take a quotient because you can't tell apart the points of the various colors. And so these configuration spaces, again, as you increase the number of points, they get more and more complicated. Especially, it's easier to see if you think about the complement, you know, where the points can come together and how they come together, those things get more and more complicated. Yes? Well, it can. It doesn't really matter because they're fixed. D is going to infinity. But yeah, maybe that's a sort of nicer result. But D is going to infinity, so that just multiplies this whole thing by some fixed.
I guess I'm confused yeah. Like why the white points are different from the red
and blue. Why? Only D is going to infinity.
Yes, only one color of the points is going to infinity. You don't have to do it that way. I stated this example. I should say there's a sort of zoo of flavors of configuration spaces where you do different things with the points, and we also do things where some points collide, but only to a limited extent. But in this example, just for a concrete example, only one of the colors of points is going to infinity. So you have, you know, two red points and three blue points, but you're increasing your number of white points, but they're not allowed to hit any of your other points. So this exists, and we give a zeta function formula for the answer, for the limit. Our proof of this, I mentioned this because the proof actually allows us, in the interior of the proof, if we're careful, the proof allows us to get the point counting corollary. This, I'll say corollary because it's not actually always a corollary, but our limit and our formulas hold, in fact, for point counting over a finite field. And so this is an example where, with a little bit of extra work, you can actually get a theorem in point counting. These configuration spaces recently have been a really exciting area in topology. So when we proved this theorem, Tom Church and Oscar Randall Williams had just proven that, let's say you don't have any of the colored points, but you just have all your points are distinct. So Tom Church and Oscar Randall Williams had just proven homological stability for these configuration spaces. And one of the reasons that it was a pretty recent result is, here again, even if you're just looking at configuration spaces of degree d points, there's not a natural map, either from d points to d plus 1 or d plus 1 to d, because you don't know which point to throw away, because they're all the same. And so that was a big, that was a big obstacle for proving stability in topology. And then of course, we said to Tom, well, this is just one example, but we said, Tom, in all of these sort of riches of kinder configuration spaces, you should be able to prove homological stability. And Tom Church was able to prove homological stability for this particular variety, variety is a bad word, flavor of configuration space. But we're also interested in configuration spaces where points can come together to a limited extent. where we prove results in the growth and degree. And just recently, in a series of four papers, Coopers, Miller, and Tran proved homological stability for these configuration spaces where you allow points to come together, but just to a limited extent, sort of as our results in the growth and degree suggested. But another thing that is interesting, which is in the topological homological stability results for these configuration spaces and various flavors. But for even just the configuration space of D, right? So these are distinct unordered points. D distinct unordered points. While they have, you just recently, Tom Church and Oscar Randy Williams proved that the Betti numbers of these stabilize as D goes to infinity, they have no idea what the limits are, in even incredibly simple cases. And whereas we can kind of guess what the limits are, because we not only say that the limits exist, but we give these Zeta function formulas, and as the sort of simplest example where we can really say something is in these, let's say I'm taking affine space and I'm taking, right, so just, so I'm taking affine space and I'm taking, these here again, points, the colored points where the number of y points is going to infinity. So the topological methods prove homological stability as D goes to infinity, but are giving nothing as to say what the actual values are. But in the growth and degree, even though these are not projective, they're open, we, by doing a little bit of extra work in the growth and degree, we, even though here, the cohomology here does not always have the degree equal to the weight, we understand enough about the weights of the cohomology of these varieties that even though they're not projective, we, our results in the growth and degree actually give the stable values, give zeta function formulas for the stable values of the singular homology here by degree, with a little extra knowledge about the weight structure, the mixed Hodge structure on that homology. Okay, thanks.
Refinement of what?
The question is, so he said, you get the point count of the corollary in one situation and not the other. Should there be some better filtration, some refinement or some better filtration that would work with point counting? I mean, it's nice to imagine, but I should say that for example, in Wood's theorem, the hardest part is that he really has to do some work to make sure that there are not too many points on these things who you know the dimensions are not so big. And so somehow there's some real work in seeing that there aren't so many points on things that you might be able to easily see have small dimension. And so somehow, because there's real work there, there has to be something non-trivial happening. So here, we have to do things in such a way that we can control that our low dimension things don't have too many points. And so we have to do some work. And so it doesn't seem like there's anything that is going to just give you that for free. There'd have to be something really, really non-trivial going on to get a more direct path you know, from a completion, and the growth mean rate to a completion of point counting.
More questions?
Yes.
So, for the configuration spaces, your very last result here,
Understanding
basically you compute the growth mean rate, and then you compute the growth mean rate polynomial, and then you do some further work to get actual bedding numbers.
Yes. We did some transformation. We proved basically like there's an operator on this, on our Hodge-Lean polynomial that then produces the Poincaré polynomial.
Yeah, so can you do something similar for the case of smooth hypersurfaces and, you know, guess what the actual bedding number are for a like
Yeah, that's a great question. So before Tomasi's work, we made a conjecture in our paper about something like that, how you should be able to operate on our Hodge-Lean polynomial and get the stable bedding numbers, and then we were wrong. So Tomasi, you know, she did it. She found some of the first few values, and you know, we get out of like the sixth number, we were wrong. You know, so. And then once we take that into account, it's like, oh, now we know what we would conjecture, but maybe we're a little humbler making that conjecture, because it's like, well, that's only our conjecture until somebody tells us the next thing we're wrong about. But I think it's certainly a great question. You know, so we wouldn't be as bold to make a conjecture, but I think that we certainly do have thoughts about that, and it's interesting. Question in these examples with so much structure, you know, where you really probably can say more about how weights and degrees of cohomology are intertwined. Yes?
So, in these results, you're looking at linear systems with their handful of variables.
Yeah.
What about maybe baseline three, or other stability results?
Yeah, that's a great question. So, let's just go back. So in the point counting case, Daniel Ehrman and I have joint work where linear systems where you're growing only by a semi-ample divisor, instead of adding an ample divisor each time you're adding a semi-ample divisor, we prove the analog of Poonen's results. About the point count over finite fields, and I think that there is probably an analogous result in the growth and degree for growing multiples by semi-ample divisors.
Fixed ample plus multiples of a semi-ample.
Yeah, fixed ample plus multiples of a semi-ample, it is not known a growth and degree for. Refinements, but a Grundy-Green version of my work with Ehrman for where you fix ample plus multiples of a semi-ample divisor is not known. But I would conjecture it.
So let's thank the speaker again.